Tēnā koutou, welcome back. We want to throw you a pop quiz. So have a look at the screen. This guy, this woman, and this woman. Answer? None of them are actually people. Those are images generated by artificial intelligence, approximations of human beings, built using pattern recognition technology fed by data from millions of images online. Let's have a look again. Yeah, none of these people actually exist. In the last few months, since the release of ChatGPT, conversations around artificial intelligence have taken on a greater prominence, with many in the tech community signing an open letter calling for a six-month pause in AI development. Jonnie Penn is an assistant teaching professor of AI ethics and society at the University of Cambridge. He was visiting New Zealand this week for the Future State event, and I asked him to assess the current state of AI development.
I think the one way to separate kind of fact from fiction, in my view, about the future of AI and where we are now, is we have a very powerful set of tools that are, you know, if you've never come across the tools before, you can think of them as kind of pattern recognition on steroids. So it can notice things that maybe a group of 10,000 humans, if they really put their minds to it, could notice, but this is just an algorithm off the shelf, you know? Mm. So we've got this fantastic tool. That some see as fantastic enough to treat as sentient, as kind of cognitive, as akin to, you know, our own neural architecture. And I challenge that. And it doesn't mean that the tools aren't incredible, but they just aren't incredible in the same ways that the human beings are.
Yeah, unpack that for me. Why do you challenge that?
One of the reasons is, you know, the field of AI historically has only been kind of marginally interested in the brain. They like to mimic it, they like to borrow from it, but they're not interested in copying it one for one. And so, you know, the brain is a chemical engine, you know, and AI isn't interested in those dynamics necessarily. It's interested in the dynamics of thought. And so we're mimicking certain aspects, you know, our abilities to be rational, you know, is trying to distill what we see there. And that's a phenomenal project, but it's only a portion of human intelligence that we're trying to kind of copy, you know? Mm. We're not copying empathy. Mm. We're not copying sympathy or compassion or other human parts of our cognition. And so we lose some of that, you know, when we're just copying the kind of hyper-rational aspects of ourselves.
So to go to the extreme end, the very extreme end of some of the doomsday predictions, does this mean, in your view, we don't need to be concerned about machines taking over?
I don't think we need to be concerned about machines taking over. I think we need to be concerned about capitalism becoming so central, power becoming so centralized that regular folks just don't have a chance to compete. Mm-hmm. And who does that serve? It doesn't serve the majority, you know. And I think for small and medium-sized businesses, for even small and medium-sized institutions, universities, you know, that are struggling to make budgets, teachers and keeping teachers employed, things like this, the idea that one set of, or a small set of corporations are going to replace all jobs with AI just doesn't seem, that seems like a bigger worry than killer robots. Mm-hmm. And thankfully, the community is kind of AI researchers and people that do AI ethics like I do, have come around to that. There's still, in the far future, concern that we'll reach a point that machines will become, you know, that people allude to it as sentient or something more cognitive. But historically, I just don't think we're close to that at all.
Let's talk about some of the concerns within the community. So in recent months, we've seen significant pushback to AI from many in the tech scene. The likes of Elon Musk, Steve Wozniak have called for a six-month pause in AI development. Jeffrey Hinton, the so-called godfather of artificial intelligence, has quit Google, warning of artificial intelligence's risk. So where do you stand on the present dangers?
So I didn't sign the letter for a pause, in part because I think we should take that idea of restraint, hold it and hit it with a hammer and break it into 1,000 pieces.
Right.
And use that idea of holding back and being more deliberate with precision. So in what areas ought we to be concerned? You know, in England, in Boston, local municipalities have passed moratoriums on facial recognition technologies for government use because they say this just isn't worth it. You know, the pros do not outweigh the cons. Mm. And so I developed this idea of what I'm calling kind of rest engineering, that in the same way that music has structural rests and notes and you need to design with both, with the future of AI, what I'm advocating for is that we kind of deliberately avoid some uses and focus on the areas that we know it can be useful. And broadly, those are the uses that we ought to avoid are around predicting social phenomena. Because if you've, let's say, predicting someone's likelihood to succeed in school, if you've ever had a teacher that inspires you, you know that your, you know, anticipated trajectory can be much different from where you get to go if someone really shows up for you.
Yeah.
And so if we read the future too, kind of with too much expectation, as if our destinies are written, I think we'll limit ourselves.
Right.
And so, yes to using AI for its strengths, but not using it around areas that are just kind of more pseudoscientific than actual science.
So to be clear, you don't think a 6-month pause would be effective?
I mean, a 6-month pause is just, it's arbitrary and infeasible. Mm. Who's gonna go for that? And I think even the people that signed it know that.
Yeah.
But if they really believe that, I'm kind of yes-anding. I'm saying, okay, if that's what you want, where in particular, what uses are you so worried about? And why can't we rally politicians around those uses?
So you're concerned about centralization, around the decisions for AI's futures being made by a very select elite few.
Yeah.
If we're to follow the REST engineering principles, who should decide where we do and don't use AI?
Okay, so this is the funny thing. You know, I talk about the fact that people are burdened right now. Mm. We live in a moment of multiple overlapping crises, with mental health crisis, the climate crisis, racial justice movement, things like this. And the idea behind AI in principle is that it'll save us time. And we need that time to solve all these other crises, right? Mm-hmm. But the thought behind REST engineering is that if we don't start kind of now, today, finding ways to give people time to step back and reflect on where the world's going, then we're gonna rush into something that we don't actually want. You know, so in the same way, historically, that the weekend was kind of formalized through the Industrial Revolution, we have to think about this present moment as deserving of social innovation.
Right.
We've got this technical innovation. What is the social innovation that matches it? It could be, you know, the 3-day weekend. It could be, for parents out there, paid childcare, depending on what country you're in. But some sort of, you know, widely available reprieve from this onslaught of obligation. If that, like, if AI is truly here to save us time and to improve our productivity, prove it.
Right.
That's what I'm saying.
Okay, but back to my question, who should be responsible for introducing a framework for areas in which it should and shouldn't be used?
Yeah.
So who should decide where the moratorium should stand?
The fun part is, I mean, so that's the full answer to that question is kind of kaleidoscopic. It should be all of the above and more. There will inevitably, I'm sure, be a kind of global AI regulatory watchdog. You know, many people have called for that. It'll probably come. But that is to put all of our hopes and dreams in top-down regulatory governance. You know, that addresses some of the problems like centralization of power. But ultimately, the thing I get excited about is bottom-up countercultural responses, because
right.
we're already seeing it. To give you a quick example, when people are getting kind of fatigued with digital tools. So in automobile manufacturing, people have said, we don't actually want screens in the car. They're dangerous, they distract us when we're driving. We want knobs, good old knobs.
Yeah.
The humble knob
yeah.
has a purpose. And I think the future of AI is gonna have a lot more humble decision-making in it. To give you another quick example, for young people dating today, you know, almost as a rule, online dating apps are, you know, what one would turn to for people of all ages, not just young people. And there's a new kind of analog alternative called the pair ring that is just a teal color ring that you wear that says to the world that you're single. It starts conversations and it solves a problem with a primitive, simple, unsophisticated, reliable solution that, you know, in contrast, the kind of digital ethos seems over-engineered and more sophisticated than we need. And the reason I call it REST engineering is we have to be deliberative of, as in music, where we put the rests and where we put the notes.
It's interesting to hear someone who's dedicated their working life and study to technology talking about the importance of less technology in our lives.
Well, it's, I mean, like, look, the future of climate instability is going to force some very tough conversations and some very tough decisions about where we rely on these tools. We've already seen, like with the supply chain mix-up following COVID, you know, automobile manufacturers were, it was hard to get a car.
Yeah.
I don't know if it's hard in this country. It's hard in Canada to buy a car.
Yeah.
Because if chips aren't available, if the chip supply chains go down, you know, the digital infrastructure goes down. So it's, digital infrastructure is not as stable and reliable as people assume. And so as in this country, you've had massive flooding, you've had landslides. In Canada, we have wildfires. We have all sorts of our own problems. To think that we're going to rely on a tool set that is not resilient, is, it just doesn't add up.
Mm.
So we have to be thoughtful about where, you know, we have to start having a conversation about threading these aspirations of a kind of ubiquitous automated future with what we know is coming, which is challenge. And to try and, you know, as I said, there will be the top-down regulatory solutions, but for regular people to assert their consumer preferences. And I'll give you one final example of what I mean. In the Netherlands, seniors said, we don't want automated checkout. We want to talk to somebody at the supermarket. And so they instituted slow lanes in certain grocery stores where you can go and have a conversation with your checkout person. And that shouldn't be unimaginable for the future.
And there's not an unexpected item in the bagging area, which always seems to be my problem. So much of this conversation is dominated by these big figures, by a select few big figures, the likes of Elon Musk. What do you make of the way that Elon Musk in particular injects himself into these conversations and debates?
Look, I've met Elon. I understand he is exceptionally good at his craft, but I don't go to him first for news on AI. I'll put it that way. Mm.
Craft being
Salesmanship. he sells, and you know he's made a career off of, as with Steve Jobs, you know, marketing the hard work of others. That is a skill in itself. But, you know, the people I look to, the leaders in the AI ethics community are people like Timnit Gebru and Margaret Mitchell, who are, you know, not tech CEOs, who do not have the vested interests that, you know, the CEOs of AI or of Google and Microsoft and things have. They're regular people that see a problem and want to solve it. You know, Timnit Gebru was fired from Google for trying to solve it. And so the idea, and I push tech journalists on this in particular, the idea that you know, technological expertise translates to expertise about our future and about our society, I question that link, because I don't think it does. I think, as I've said, we need social innovation. Who does social innovation? You know, care workers, nurses, teachers, regular people who deal with other regular people and design a world that regular people want to live in.
It's interesting to hear you speak with such optimism about our species and about our societal structure, given some of these challenges and given what we have seen throughout the digital revolution so far and the way that a select few tech companies have defined the way in which we interact with digital technology.
I mean, I've had my dark days to worry about that, I think I got to a point where I thought, you know, there's so much to be worried about already, and to think that now we have to worry about, you know, the centralization of power, the pollution of our information channels with misinformation and AI-powered misinformation and disinformation, job loss, things like that. You know, in some sense, I think, and Gen Z are good at this, that we have to avoid the kind of toxic positivity where, like, everything has to be rosy. We can talk about the dark things that we have and try and manage them, because actually we share these worries and it'll bring us together to share them openly. But also, you know, every generation has their struggles. Our ancestors have dealt with massive amounts of tragedy and pain and have faced incredible obstacles and have adapted. And so we have a lot on our plate, but I think we just have to do the best we can. And in doing the best we can, I think we have to focus on local issues and not get too hyper-fixated on the kind of the globe itself, because the globe itself is constituted of local places. And we have to take care of our homes and our schools and our communities first, I would say. And that matters for AI. Something I was thinking about on the walk over here to join you today was, you know, New Zealand as a country ought to start negotiating. They do already in some sense, but New Zealanders ought to feel like, if AI is going to be a part of my life, what do I get in return? You know, because as I said, technological innovation comes in. What is the social innovation that matches it? And I can give you one final historical example of this. the printing press is often treated as the kind of exemplar of technological determinism.
Yeah.
It was invented, the world became literate. That's not what happened. It was invented 400 years past, and then there was a push to make elementary school widely accessible. Mm. That's what unlocked the potential for mass literacy. And so in the same way, I'm in REST engineering, I'm inviting everybody who enjoys REST, which is most people, to think about what are the customs we need, what are the rituals we need, what are the ceremonies we need that have as much charisma and remind us of our joys as much as like binging on TikTok, which is fun, you know, but yeah. We need complementary social alternatives. Mm. That's what I'm kind of pushing for.